I found a video of Dr. Pal where he is in conversation with Satvic Movement. There were two parts to that podcast and I watched the whole of the first one. And boy oh boy, there were a lot of questionable things that were said on that podcast. And I decided to make a detailed video on the main things that were discussed in that podcast with all the necessary sources in the description below. My name's Prana. You're watching my brand new channel, DD Rational. Okay, it's not exactly a new channel, I've just renamed my second channel. Anyway, let's begin. If there's one brand that I wanted to sponsor my videos, that would be this brand. And today I can proudly say they are the sponsors of this video. Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce you to Stayqrious. Stayqrious New School is an innovative virtual school founded by Anand Srinivas, the former content head at Khan Academy. Okay, so let me tell you what they've done. We all graduate from school thinking, hey, if only this XYZ aspect of school could be changed, or if only schools focused a little more on this ABC aspect. Well, imagine if someone actually did that. That's what Stayqrious is. And they've done that based on some whims and fancies. They've used research-based, evidence-based ways of optimizing learning and hands-on teaching methods. One example is from a research paper linked down below of how student performance improves to outcomes that are typically expected of the top 2% simply by making sure the student receives more personal attention, which is why they have a 1:8 coach to student ratio and additional one-on-one coaching as needed. They've revolutionized the traditional education system by getting students to actively engage in projects that mirror real workplace challenges.
I make a very cheap electric toothbrush, okay. And they can also connect it to the iPad. So there will be a Spider-Man design on the electric toothbrush, and while they are brushing, they can see on the iPad that the whole Spider-Man should be colored, and that's representing how clean their teeth are.
Interesting. Wow. Okay. Interesting idea.
They prioritize the mental health of students and student well-being over academic pressure, which we can all agree India needs. And this is my favorite part. They teach students to tackle real-world skills, where the student learns to spot fake news, manage social media anxiety, and even build a mini financial portfolio. Skills that are essential today but are rarely taught in schools. And given that they are so committed to critical thinking, Stayqrious aligns so well to my own values, and I'm sure those of my audience. The very things I talk about on rationality, on not falling prey to scams, on logical fallacies and biases are their focus too. In today's day and age, with the things I see on social media, especially in a country like India, I worry about young children that are exposed to this. And I'm sure so do a lot of you. And it's companies like Stayqrious that fill me with hope. You might not be a parent yourself, but if there's a child that you know who might benefit from this, be it a niece or a nephew or a cousin or a friend's child, please share this with them. Note that this is a complete replacement for schools and they follow an international curriculum. Right now, they are at a starting stage and their focus is on classes 4 and 5. But they soon plan to add more classes to their repertoire. Anyone who joins right now will have their education covered till high school. For the academic year 2024-25, the admissions are open for kids aged 8 to 10. And here's the best part. For my audience, if you use the link I've provided down below, the admission fees that you have to pay will be completely waived. Make use of this opportunity for your child to help them navigate this complex world. And now on to the video. First things first, new channel, what's up with that? I'll tell you in detail at the end of this video. I want to address the fans of Dr. Pal who have clicked on this video and don't know who I am. Who's this guy trying to refute Dr. Pal? He's an actual doctor. What has this guy studied? Engineering? In what world does he think he knows better than Dr. Pal? I've actually gotten exactly those kinds of responses before. So let's talk about it. When one person is saying one thing and someone else is saying something else, who do I believe? Like right now, what I'm saying versus what Dr. Pal is saying. Can I look at a person's qualifications to determine who's right? No, because now you end up committing the fallacy of appeal to authority. I'm not saying qualifications don't determine anything. I'm just saying that they don't determine who's right. And you know what does guarantee the correctness of the information being said? The information itself, the content of what they say. Dr. Pal has in the past said things like cooked foods like dosha are good probiotics.
Dosa, like any other fermented food, is rich in microorganisms, rich in probiotics, which will aid in digestion and promote good gut bacteria.
This is completely wrong. No cooked food contains live bacteria and hence cannot be a probiotic. It seems Dr. Pal is only popular because most of the info he puts out is consumed by people that are not trained in science. All you need is the most basic training to know this isn't true. And as a result of all this, he never gets called out. Let's change that, shall we? He has said that Oreos are extremely harmful to our health and you should never eat them.
So this is very, very famous, but the most important thing you need to look into this is high fructose corn syrup. So whenever you see high fructose corn syrup on the label, just run away from it. It is absolutely not good. I know your kids will love it. But if you want your kids to stay with you for a long time, you need to make sure that this biscuit is not in your pantry.
Then why, Dr. Pal, are they even available in the market? I mean, if they're so harmful, then are there no food regulation authorities that look at these things? Or did they just overlook such mass marketed products? The fact is, there's nothing wrong in eating Oreos, provided you're eating a well-balanced diet where you're getting enough fiber and all the nutrients your body needs without eating excess calories. And that high fructose corn syrup claim he made, let's see what the US FDA, Food Regulation Authority from the US, what they have to say about it. No evidence that it's harmful. By the way, notice here that high fructose corn syrup is around 50% fructose. Fun fact, your normal table sugar that you eat is 50% fructose. If you're scared of this, are you equally scared of that too? No, right? Then what's the logic in being scared of this? The problem with processed foods like Oreos is that if they're the only thing you eat, if they're the only thing in your diet, then your diet will lack certain nutrients and that will affect your health. But Oreos by themselves, not a problem. He said many other questionable things. I've done a detailed video taking a look at the questionable claims he's made, which is up on this channel. You can watch it after you're done with this video. Now, I'm not saying that he's not a good doctor or anything. He probably is. Very empathetic and caring towards patients, and he probably treats them well. I'm not even saying that everything he said is wrong. I've seen him say things that are correct and useful as well. But I would never recommend that you watch him. Given that he has a tendency to put out misinformation, someone who doesn't know the actual science of something can easily fall prey to it. So this is why I say he's problematic. He's a really bad science communicator. Because as a good science communicator, your job is to make sure your audience gets a fair idea of how they can determine for themselves if what they're hearing is right or wrong. And Dr. Pal does none of that. You'll see that as this video goes on. Satvic Movement are pseudoscience creators with millions in their audience who promote chemophobia and fear-mongering through pseudoscience of not only food, but even things like radiations from mobile phones while posting their content from mobile phones.
Every time you use your devices while they are charging, all the dirty radiation and the electricity flows through you and creates cancer inside your bodies.
They should do a course on how to become hypocrites 101, and their favorite buzzword happens to be cancer. Now, these two also promote something called a Satvic diet, which is not based on any science or research, but from a collection of personal experiences, aka anecdotes. I made a detailed video on their radiation fear-mongering, which I'll link down below. Now, people might argue saying, hey, you should give someone the benefit of the doubt. He probably just made a mistake by calling them on. We're all human, aren't we? Sure, if this were a mistake, I'd understand. Because genuine mistakes are usually followed up with the person accepting responsibility for the mistake and owning up. And I don't see that here. In fact, if he were to admit his own mistakes and own up to them, then I'd respect him a lot more. But instead of all that, this is what he seems to have done. He posted a clip of that podcast as a reel on Instagram, but when he saw that it was getting a lot of negative comments and reviews, he just nicely, silently deleted it. No statement on stories, no nothing. That, my friends, is the mark of someone who has no integrity and is only interested in growth. Some of you might say, hey, he just had a conversation with them. There's nothing wrong in having a conversation. You're just saying that he's guilty by association. Having a conversation is fine. But what is the nature of that conversation? Is it skeptical? Is there any pushback on their points that were clearly BS? Is there any countering of the misinformation that they're bringing to the table? One example for exactly this kind of podcast is one by Dr. Mike featuring Dr. Gundry, where it was clear that the two had disagreements and Dr. Mike countered every bit of misinformation brought up by Dr. Gundry. Was this conversation like that, or was Dr. Pal just platforming these people, letting them say whatever they want, spread their misinformation with little or no resistance? Well, I'll let you watch my review of what they spoke about and let you decide for yourself. Or maybe you could even watch the original podcast and decide for yourself. If he were platforming them, then you'll agree that he's just exploiting the trust his audience has in him for views by collaborating with these creators regardless of their content, simply because they have a large audience. It's when science communication takes a backseat and social media growth becomes more important. Let's now take a look at the actual podcast and see what are the points that came up. I'm obviously not gonna play the entire podcast, just the points that I thought were most important. Once again, I'm not trying to deceive anyone or anything by twisting their point. This is actually what was discussed during the podcast. If you feel like I've taken anything out of context, then feel free to say so in the comments. I never delete any comments. It's usually YouTube that auto-moderates them if it deems them as abusive, or maybe if the comment has some link in it or whatever. Or if you don't believe me, you can always watch the original podcast. Let's get into it.
So we would go and the doctor would always give something a little expensive and we would get excited. If this is expensive, it has to work. No, this will cure. This is the final magical pill.
Oh man, these are anti-medicine views being freely expressed on a doctor's podcast with no pushback whatsoever. This is an obvious fallacy where the cost of a medicine has nothing to do with the actual effectiveness of the medicine. But does Dr. Pat clear this up anywhere in the podcast? Nope. If I was there, I would ask questions to try and get to the bottom of this. Was this a case of misdiagnosis? Or was he given medicines to manage symptoms like inhalers and ointments and he thought it was supposed to cure him when it didn't? Was this just a communication gap between the doctor and the patient? All these questions should have come from Dr. Pal. Instead, he just lets it go and the audience gets a takeaway that modern medicines are bad. And it's your diet that plays the ultimate role in determining your health. Now, I do agree that the food we eat has a huge role in determining our health. And we'll speak more on food and diet soon. But coming back to this, the conclusion that medicines did nothing cannot be made so quickly. When hearing all this, you should keep in the back of your head that medicines undergo research and testing and approval before they get prescribed to a patient. And when you hear stories like every case that he has ever known is a result of failure of medicines, you have to get skeptical. Hey, something doesn't add up statistically.
Imagine I have a flower vase in my hand and it's a glass vase and it's a little dirty. But no matter how much you scrub, you realize it's not getting cleaned. Then you take your hand with the cloth and you put it in the mouth of the glass. Then you wipe it with the inside wall of the glass and you take the hand out and you see the patch is now sparkling clean.
Yeah, and they're gonna associate this with the body, I think. Let's keep watching.
We have a skin problem. We want to put an ointment on it. We want to put some, get some expensive face wash for it, the best moisturizer for it. And we want to fix our blemishes, everything from the outside. We want to put a cover up on it. But what we don't realize is that the problem actually exists inside. The problem exists within us.
Does anyone see the fallacy here? This is a false analogy, and analogies can never be used to conclude how things are. Now, our bodies are not like a glass vase. We cannot make the conclusion that it's always the case that the problem exists within us. Take an infectious disease, for example, always caused by an external pathogen. And if you don't get external treatment and care, then your diet alone can't do anything. Now, I don't think they're trying to say that every single disease is caused by something that exists within us. But even then, there's a huge thing just to ignore. And the way they're saying it and the way they're presenting it makes it very easy for the audience to misinterpret it.
So when you ask that, what is the food that we share at Satvic Movement? It is that which can be easily processed and digested by this gut so that it doesn't collect, accumulate and create waste inside the gut. As long as that food can get easily digested by the gut, we term it as Satvic food.
So much misinformation here. Firstly, you know what's the easiest food for the body to digest? Processed foods, simple sugars, etc. Something I know Satvic Movement is heavily against. But as soon as you add some complex carbs or fiber, food becomes harder for your body to digest. They're getting some facts mixed up here. Now, I'm not saying that adding complex carbs or fibers like fruits is a bad thing for the body. Quite the opposite. Fiber is one of the healthiest things you can eat. And proteins, which are the most essential micronutrients, even more than carbs or fats, are the hardest thing for your body to digest. So something being easier to digest doesn't make it good food. Another thing is that food cannot accumulate in your gut without causing some issue like bowel obstruction, which is a rare medical emergency that requires surgery. But otherwise, the body is designed to push out everything that comes into your gut. Now, even if she didn't mean exactly this, she's still giving the audience an easy opportunity to misinterpret everything she said and make poor decisions as a result. And I expect Dr. Pal to clear all these things out, but he just lets it go.
Food is not inert. It has life in it. Mm-hmm. And when we eat food that has life, it will give us life. Then there is food which we term as dead food.
Mm.
There is per se no prana or no life force. Mm. So when we eat that, it's not going to give us life. We are not deciding whether it has nutrition or not, whether it has vitamins or not, because we are not looking at food with that aspect. Mm. We are saying, does it have life in it to give us that basic life that we need?
And this right here is textbook pseudoscience. This whole idea of prana or life energy is an idea from ancient science that has no grounding in evidence, no grounding in reality. And they don't look at food in terms of vitamins and nutrients. That's a problem. And again, I'm beating a dead horse here because I expect Dr. Pal to say something. But he does nothing. He agrees with his guests completely and names this section of the video, Food Has Life. Now, even though their logic is faulty, their conclusion has merit. They're saying that you should have a lot of natural whole foods, which you should. Not because it contains any prana or life energy, but because it contains vitamins and a lot of nutrition, which they don't care about. A lot more than processed foods.
Let's say we cut an apple and we leave it out. How long will it survive? Not too long. I mean, it'll start rotting and smelling and it'll go bad. And now we are, I think 3 hours is, you can't eat that after 3 hours. Imagine what's inside those packets. How much time have they been there? Not even 3 days, 3 weeks, 3 months. Sometimes even 3 years.
Okay, this is really bad logic. Let's talk about this. Why do we need to be able to store food? Because not everyone has the luxury or the privilege or the time like these people to eat freshly plucked and cut fruits all the time. To increase the availability and accessibility of these foods to every section of society, we need to be able to store foods. But now we have a problem. A freshly cut apple over time because of contamination gets a growth of bacteria and fungi which causes it to rot. And now it's harmful to us. So we need to find a way of preventing this rotting. The answer? Preservatives. And unlike what people say, preservatives are there for making the food safer. And adding it doesn't make the food more safe. If anything, it makes the food more bitter. Brands will see their sales go down if they add more preservatives. They will try to add the least amount of preservatives possible while still making their food safe to eat. And for something like a big packet of ketchup, what you need, the amount of preservatives that you need is just a pinch. And these doses are tightly controlled legally and safety tested by the food regulatory authority of the country. In India's case, that's the FSSAI. You can watch the conversation I had with a nutritionist regarding this, which I'll link down below. So if you're buying foods under this regulatory setup, then please don't worry about preservatives after listening to these people. But that won't stop them though.
It's the one where ultra processed foods come in, which are loaded with additives, preservatives, with synthetic colors, with sugars, with refined oils. And those, I would say, make up most of our supermarket shelves today.
Frozen foods that we see, that's all in the red list.
They're also against freezing foods. Please don't take science advice from these guys and Dr. Pal either. I can say that confidently after this video. Freezing foods is completely safe, and you don't have to believe me. You can check out this article from the US FDA website. There's very minimal loss of nutrients, and that too, it only happens when you take it out and reheat the foods. And that loss of nutrients is minimized when you reheat it in a microwave oven. By the way, Satvic Movement also hates microwaves. I've made a full video on that, like I said, link down below.
What is closest to nature? That will give us the most energy. And what is furthest away from the way nature has given to us, that will give us the least or no energy.
If you've seen more of Satvic Movement's content, then you'll know they're big promoters of this naturalistic fallacy. Anything from nature is great and anything that is not is bad. You know that a cancer is natural, right? Is that good? Even tens of thousands of years before civilization, people used to get cancers. You know that, right? Are cancers good? Okay, forget that. The microbes that contaminate food and make that freshly cut apple go bad, rot, as you say, they're all natural, right? So are they good? Clearly, this natural synthetic dichotomy is not what you should go with. And quite often, this is combined with scaring people by saying, hey, chemicals.
It'll undergo an industrial refinement process where lots of industrial chemicals will be added to it, and we'll have this refined sesame oil.
Like I said, we can't say something is bad based on some principle which is not even based on any evidence. Sure, there may be some synthetic chemical that may be harmful, but without any evidence of that, you cannot label something as bad. And you know who tests and finds that evidence? Food regulatory authorities. The entire refinement process is made sure to be safe by these bodies. None of these things are made clear by our friendly neighborhood gut health expert, Dr. Pal.
See, I strongly believe that allopathic medicine cannot work alone. So that's why it says alone, cannot work alone.
There was this whole section of the podcast where Dr. Pal was using the term allopathic medicine. Please stop using that term, because number one, that was a derogatory term created by the inventor of homeopathy, Samuel Hahnemann, to describe everything wrong with medicine at his time. That was 18th century Europe. Number two, the term allopathy refers to heroic medicine of medieval Europe, not the medicine of today. If you want to refer to that, call it modern medicine or evidence-based medicine or just medicine. Because anything that isn't evidence-based isn't medicine. And I mean everything that comes under alternative medicine isn't medicine. I've got multiple videos elaborating the problems with alternative medicine. Feel free to watch them. Back to this, it really disappoints me when a modern medicine doctor calls his own practice allopathy, spreading this wrong notion to his audience. And even worse, spreading this notion that it can't work alone and it has to be combined with alternative medicine to create this integrated medicine which will be more beneficial to patients. This is pure BS. I've seen him beat this drum before, and I can assure you that this is a result of his own bias and not any evidence. Combining something evidence-based with something that's non-evidence-based doesn't make it better, it only makes it worse. As Dr. Happy Phillips says, when you mix apple pie with cow dung, the cow dung doesn't start tasting better, you've only made your apple pie worse.
In your practice, so you're saying that you'll eat brown rice a lot more.
So principle is not that brown rice or this rice. Eat unpolished rice, which has not been stripped away.
More fiber intact.
More fiber intact. Yes, absolutely. The bran has the fiber. And then every man or woman should have minimum of 25 grams of fiber per day.
Yes, and this 25 grams of fiber doesn't have to come from the rice bran itself. It can come from anywhere in your diet. So if you're having a balanced diet, that is, you're eating a lot of fruits and vegetables, you don't have to worry about the fiber content of your rice. You can eat white rice or brown rice and you'll be fine. In fact, they both have similar calories too. Once again, Dr. Pal gets a zero for his science communication.
There are a lot of researches done comparing the addiction level of sugar versus cocaine.
They
found that sugar is actually much more addictive than cocaine.
The sugar versus cocaine mouse study. I was wondering when this was gonna come up. And this is a tool in every sugar fearmonger's arsenal. First of all, what is addiction? It's when a substance or activity has so much power over you that you can't help but keep having it or doing it. And that too, to such an extent that it starts affecting every facet of your life. Your relationships, your financial, mental and physical health, etc. I've been addicted to gambling in the past. I know. If it's some substance you're addicted to, you'll start having withdrawal symptoms when you're denied that thing. Sugar doesn't do most of these things. It just takes a mental decision to remove sweets and snacks from your house and remove it from your diet to get rid of sugar. I'd say try doing that with cocaine and you'll see what addiction is, but I don't want to endorse cocaine on my channel. The only people who hold this view that sugar is more addictive than cocaine are the people who don't really understand addiction, because all this is really just a huge misrepresentation. You just need a little bit of effort in the beginning and you can start a habit of eating healthy. A little bit of effort, that's all you need. In fact, if it weren't fairly easy, we wouldn't have so many success stories all over social media. I've explained the basics of how to go on a diet in detail in a video that I've linked down below. I've also had a detailed discussion on this with a nutritionist, which again, I'll link down below.
Artificial sweeteners are two things. One is synthetic and the other one is plant-based. Synthetic is sucralose, aspartame. You're red, bright red.
There's a really long discussion on artificial sweeteners, which again, I'm not going to include because it's really long. You can always watch what they said in the original podcast, but briefly here, they conclude that artificial sweeteners are bad because they almost always are synthetic. But Dr. Pal talks about a patient of his who switched from regular Coke to Diet Coke and lost a lot of weight. And he attributes that to the only benefit that artificial sweeteners have, which is that they're zero calorie. A lot of food fearmongers scare people over aspartame being possibly linked to cancer. Food Pharma is my favorite example.
Biggest news in health today. Aspartame, the sweetener used in Diet Coke, is going to be listed as a possible carcinogen.
This carcinogenicity of aspartame has only been established in mouse models, where the mice were given 1,000 times the typical dosage. I can prove even regular table salt is toxic by giving it to mice at such dosages. What about in human randomized controlled trials? Every single one of those studies failed to find any evidence of negative effects on humans. I'll show a few on screen and link them below for you to read. And at this point, I have to recommend the best channel I know that debunks this kind of health misinformation. You should get your health information from him rather than people like Dr. Pal and Satvic Movement, who are champions of misinformation. And that is none other than Dr. Lane Norton. He's a nutrition PhD who is active on social media and breaks down studies while analyzing claims. Definitely check him out. He goes by BioLane on social media. I'd also say keep aside your biases of always wanting your information to come from an Indian page and check him out. I leave links to his YouTube and Instagram pages down below. If there's one takeaway for this video, like you watched all this so far, and if there's one thing that I want to, one message I want to convey, it's this. Just because someone has a doctor in front of their name doesn't mean they know what they're talking about. They could be talking pure BS, like Dr. Pal here. I've seen people on social media who are not doctors in the medical sense of the term, who use that title in front of their name to make their advice sound more credible. So be careful the next time you see an influencer with the title doctor. Sometimes they may not be all that trustworthy. That's it for this analysis. I'll now address what's going on with the channel. I've always wanted to segregate my content into pure science and fighting pseudoscience. And I've decided to upload all my science content over there on Science is Dope and all my pseudoscience content over here on DD Rational. The name is just a pun on the TV channel DD National, if anyone isn't aware. It's an old TV channel we used to have here in India in case any Zoomer is watching. Now, Science is Dope is gonna have all my science content that I'm gonna produce from here on out. And DD Rational will have all my rationality content, and that includes atheism. All my old rationality content like the Pseudoscience Police videos are gonna remain there on Science is Dope. But any new ones that I produce from now on are gonna be here. Subscribe to whichever channel you like, and if you'd like to support my content, you can give me a one-time support using one of these options, or give me continued support using one of these options, for which you will get perks that you see on your screen. Make sure you click on the link below and check out Stayqrious New School. Thank you, Stayqrious, for sponsoring this video. I'll see you in the next one.